that just mentioned, of course, and also science. So deep learning, machine learning in general, deep learning in particular, is transforming science, the way we do science. There's a lot of use of deep learning now in high energy physics, in astronomy, in astrology, in biology, of course, it's been going on for a while. But also in political science and social science. And so a lot of sciences that are now being done by essentially collecting data and analyzing it with phenomenological models that are essentially, a lot of them are becoming deep learning problems now. So the deep learning methods. So let's talk first about scientific and research challenges, and there's a lot of them. In fact, that's my biggest slide. You know, we have a need for systems that require less supervision, essentially. So that can be trained from raw data that has not been hand-labeled by people. And there's quite a lot of progress in this direction, but we're still very far from where we need to be. So to give you an example, one big problem that Facebook is trying to solve is doing content moderation, which has become a huge problem in some of the press. But that has to be done in 7,000 languages. Some of it don't actually have standards for how you translate them into bytes. And so, you know, how do you do something like moderate content, like hate speech, for example, fake news, if you don't even understand the language and there's no data to train anything on it? Right? So we have to have multilingual systems that can do natural language understanding and translation with very little data. We'd like to have perceptual systems like vision, etc., and also robots that you can train with as much data as animals and humans. We don't have that. We'd like to have deep learning systems that are capable of reasoning and planning. Right now, we're pretty good at perception. We're not so good at building systems that produce actions or sequences of actions. And we're certainly not good at all at producing systems that kind of go through some, you know, explicit process of reasoning before actually producing a result or an action. And so what we need to do is do what, you know, good old-fashioned AI was doing in terms of reasoning, except we need to replace symbols by vectors and replace logic by differentiable operators so that we can, you know, put them in a deep learning system and train them. And, you know, as I said during my talk this morning, we need the ability of machines to kind of learn how the world works by observing. And that's kind of probably the most efficient way in which we learn massive amounts of background knowledge about the world as humans and animals. And that's one thing that we don't know how to do with machines yet. So that's a big scientific challenge, I think, for the next few years. Things like generative adversarial networks, but other methods as well, are very promising in that direction. And so I'm focusing my personal research mostly on this aspect, actually. And ultimately, we'd like those machines that learn how the world works from observation to acquire some sense, some level of common sense. Common sense has been a red herring in AI for decades. We don't have machines that have common sense. And we need that if you want to build things like virtual assistants that are not frustrating to talk to, for example. So where is my intelligent virtual assistant? It's not there, and it's not going to be here for quite a while. Right now, all the virtual assistants that we have are handcrafted, scripted by hand. If you go out of the script, they basically can answer your questions. And you know, ultimately, we need to achieve common sense for that. These were scientific challenges. I go back to that list here. In supervision, we need machines that can reason and plan, and machines that learn world models. We need machines with common sense. And then the last item here is what I call differentiable programming. Other people have called it this way as well. This is kind of a new way of writing programs by essentially writing a program where some modules are parameterized and somewhat differentiable. And you don't entirely specify the program, but you kind of let data sort of finalize the details of that program. So I think this is probably going to change a lot of how we program machines in the future, and that's a really exciting avenue. So technological challenges, where is my virtual assistant? That's the last question, but really that's really a scientific question more than a technological one. More specifically, technological challenges, we need parallel hardware and distributed algorithms for training. There's quite a bit of investment that goes into buying entire rooms full of GPUs, and for training, and distributed training is not a completely solved problem. So as our models become bigger and bigger, and as Moore's law saturates more and more, we're going to need to kind of find ways to massively parallelize training. We need software platforms and languages for differentiable programming, for deep learning, for the new AI, if you want. And I think the way we program 5-10 years from now is going to be very different from the way we do it now. So that is a big challenge, I think, for computer scientists mostly, but also people from this community. Another aspect, of course, which you know a lot of people here, certainly our colleagues from Samsung and others are familiar with, is low-power hardware for neural network inference. So something that allows you to run neural nets, you know, fairly large neural nets on mobile devices without draining the battery too quickly. And that's happening. There's a lot of people working on this, but I think there are kind of possibility of real revolutions here over the next few years. Next is scaling up the use of deep learning for a lot of really challenging tasks. So I was mentioning, you know, fake news and content filtering, hate speech, all kinds of things like this that are legally required to be filtered by certain countries, and that Facebook has a mandate to do, essentially. Controlling how networks are exploited for, you know, to influence public opinion, things like this. So, you know, a lot of things to do, like to do this type that require AI, essentially, where AI technology is not where it needs to be. So, you know, for example, you know, on Facebook, you have live video. You can, you know, very easily by clicking two buttons, you know, where you're on TV station, you can broadcast to the world, whatever happens here. And people use this for, you know, filming their own suicide or a murder, and you know, how do you kind of not distribute this to the entire world? You basically have to have AI systems that kind of figure this out on the fly. It's not easy. You'd like to have real-time subtitling, for example, in translation. Right? So those are technological challenges, and then there are societal challenges. AI is becoming scary to the public. And there's a definitely possibility that AI becomes, in the mind of the public, what, for example, nuclear energy was in certain countries. So depending on the sort of ambient noise in the press and the political landscape, countries that are otherwise very similar can go one way or another in favor or against a particular technology. For example, nuclear energy. Germany were completely against it in the 70s. France were all for it. And so France has, you know, 80% of its energy produced by nuclear power plants. Germany essentially none. GMOs, Europe went all against, the US went all for it. Why? So it could be that there's kind of a similar phenomenon for AI, depending on how AI is perceived in the public and depending on how it's deployed. And so we have to make AI systems that make decisions on people minimally biased. We cannot completely remove bias, but you know, we have to, there's a lot of research on how to make sure AI systems are not biased. Making them safe and reliable, and you know, measuring the economic impact before it occurs. And one of the biggest limitation of the dissemination of AI in the economy is the education of the workforce. So if a country is to take a role in the deployment of AI and take advantage of the economic advantage of it, it has to educate its workforce as fast as it can. So in terms of the scientific challenges, I mentioned the mixture of reasoning and deep learning, and there is a number of very interesting work in this area. I'm not going to explain what this is, but there are people who are using concepts of differentiable programming. This is some work that took place at Facebook a while ago. Are able to basically generate visual programs for a machine to answer a question about a picture, for example. And so the graph of operators that is generated on the fly for particular data to answer a particular question depends on the question, depends on the data, and is generated on the fly and is trained using deep learning. So this very interesting work in this area. I mentioned very briefly this morning the idea that we can apply deep learning to sort of slightly more general data types than just multi-dimensional tables of numbers. So things like functions on graphs, for example. And I contact Michael Bornstein about this. I don't know if he's here. I think I saw Eduardo, but I'm sure he's here. He's been working quite a lot on this. There is a review paper that I'm co-author on. He's the first author on this idea of sort of graph function some graphs. But you know, as I was saying this morning, we're missing some basic science for building real intelligent machines. We can't have machines with common sense. We can't have intelligent personal assistants. We can't have possible robots. We can't have AGI essentially. And we need machines to learn like babies, or animals. So as I said, the next revolution of AI will not be supervised. And you know, I'm working towards this revolution. It may happen before or after the people funding our research get tired of it. So we'll see. If we succeed before, then we'll have a new beginning for AI deep learning. If we don't succeed before, then we're going to have a new AI winter. Okay, but here is something else. Maybe a little more cosmic conclusion, perhaps. Technology drives and motivates science, and vice versa. So, if you think about the history of science and technology, the telescope was invented before optics was figured out. You know, people came up with optics afterwards to explain how telescopes work. The people kind of built telescopes beforehand with intuition. The steam engine was invented before thermodynamics was invented. In fact, thermodynamics was invented to explain, to figure out how to make steam engines more efficient, the Carnot cycle and stuff, right? Airplanes were invented before aerodynamics and stability and all that stuff was figured out. Calculators were invented before computer science, and telecommunication were invented before information theory. In fact, all of those theoretical fields were motivated by the invention of an artifact. And so now we're trying to build intelligent machines. Is it going to cause the appearance of a new science of intelligence? The equivalent of thermodynamics before intelligence. That's one of the things I'd love to see before the end of my career, but probably not. Just to finish about the societal impact of AI, there's a lot of people who talk about the fact that AI is going to take our jobs, etc. No economist that I know says that AI is going to kill jobs. It's going to displace jobs, that's for sure. Certain jobs are going to disappear, but the same way mechanization, for example, caused the fact that in the late 19th century most people were working in the fields, and now it's about 2% of the population in developed countries. So things are displaced, professions are displaced by technology. That's just the way technology works. There's nothing special about AI in that respect. But what it's going to do is that it's going to change the value we attribute to things, and it's already started. So right now you can go on online and you can buy a Blu-ray player for $47, which is incredibly cheap when you think about the sophistication of what goes into a Blu-ray player, right? H.264 compression, blue laser, it's incredible. But it's $47 because it's built by machines, essentially. Now, you want to buy a handmade ceramic bowl. The technology is about 10,000 years old, let's say 8,000 years old. It's handmade, $750. Okay. What's the difference? The difference is authentic human experience, right? Someone actually can build that bowl with their hands. So I think that's what's going to happen. The value of things that are produced by machines is going to go down, and the value of things that are authentic human experience is going to go up. Food production is cheap, but if you go to a fancy restaurant with all kinds of people taking care of you, that's expensive, right? Similar for music, right? You can download a recording of your favorite opera if you rent to that for $7, but then you want to go to the New York City Metropolitan Opera to listen to the performance. It could cost you $800, maybe $200 if you're smarter, but economists talk about AI as a general purpose technology. So what that means is that it's a technology that's going to percolate into all corners of society. But it's going to take 10 to 15 years from today, essentially. It's the same time that it took for computer technology to kind of result in an increase in productivity. So productivity started rising in the 90s, even though computer technology started appearing in the 70s. It took 20 years because it took that long for people to kind of learn how to use computers, basically. So I was really worried before talking to economists about the fact that it has the set of skills that are required by the new technology. You know, as technology evolves, the skills that are required by the new world, the new economy, is ahead of the competences that people have. And there's a bunch of people who trail behind, whose skills are not in phase with what's required. And those people are kind of left behind. They don't have jobs, right? Their value to society, to the economy at least, is not that great. And so as technology evolves faster and faster, maybe there's more and more of those people left behind. And I thought originally that was a problem. But what economists say is that it's actually the number of people who trail behind that limit the speed at which the technology disseminates in the economy. So that's kind of a self-regulatory mechanism. So what that means is that if the country wants to take advantage of a new technology like AI, it has to invest massively into education, including professional education and continuous education. The other problem that AI will cause is the fact that technological development causes increase in wealth inequality. So I'm going to be slightly political here, but only slightly. I'm just kind of parroting what I hear from economists. What they say is that, this is a chart from Eric Brynjolfsson and McAfee from MIT. What they say is that productivity has grown since the 1950s, you know, more or less continuously in the US, but the median income in the US was tracking productivity for a while until the mid-80s, and then became flat. So median income became flat. And there is no fatality to this, it's just fiscal policy. So basically when you cut taxes for the rich, that's what you get. You get increased productivity, GDP per capita going up, but median income is flat. And this is specific to the US. It hasn't happened to the same extent in Europe, or I guess not in Canada either. And that's a huge problem. That's why we have raised populism and stuff like that. There's a lot of people who feel they're left behind, and they're gonna blame it on us. They're gonna blame it on people, you know, making technological progress and bringing about AI. So we're gonna be careful to put pressure on our politicians to take care of this. Thank you very much.